Praise God.
Praise God.
I don't know about you, but I rejoiced when Linda shouted this morning, "Are you ready?" After church. I thought, you know what? It must be rubbing off a little bit, you reckon? Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I'm excited to be here this morning. I'm excited to see you all. And I can say truthfully and honestly, I've missed you.
Yeah.
Amen. I've missed you.
I missed you too.
Just, you know, it just don't seem right anymore on a Sunday not having church. And I know we had church, and I appreciate Doug and Linda filling in for me, and I knew that they would do a wonderful job.
They did.
And I tell you, it's a real relief to know. And not just Doug and Linda, there would have been others that could have stepped up. It would have. And so we just appreciate everybody that steps up. And I'll tell you, it's wonderful to be in God's house again today.
Yes.
And I know this church is not really his house. It's where we come to meet with him. But his house is really right here.
Yes.
And so, but we appreciate the opportunity. I thought this morning again, I thought, God, take your place of honor this morning. Amen. And I hope somehow that God will minister to your spirit this morning for whatever it is that you need for God to do in your life. somehow that he will walk up and down the aisles and just slip in the pew with each and every one of you and speak a word of encouragement to you. Who knows God can do that?
Yes.
I've been in churches many, many times and just been sitting there, and all of a sudden it's like God just sat down aside of me, just began to speak to you. Woo! Glory. This morning, we could have our business meeting, but I think since we had the snow and everything, we'll wait another week on that. Is that all right, then? Or you just got to do it today?
You want to do it?
So we're going to have communion this morning. was thinking, just morning of communion, the Bible says to do this in remembrance of what Jesus did for us. But you know, it ought to really be a privilege for us this morning to do this in remembrance.
It's not a sad time, it's a time to jump up and down for joy.
Yes. My, what a privilege it is for us today to do this in remembrance of what Jesus. Listen, if he hadn't done it, we couldn't do this today in remembrance of it. And because of what Jesus did on the cross, we can do this in remembrance of Jesus this morning. Isn't it a wonderful thing to be able to do this in remembrance of Jesus? Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, the Lord Jesus. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Celebrate with Christ. I count it a privilege. Amen.
Yes.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Not that there's not a ton of other good songs, but for some reason, Majesty is my favorite.
Thank you, Lord.
And Linda, I want you to just sing one more verse of that, if you will. Amen. She's doing that just for me. Amen. But I love this song. And if you listen to the words, it speaks such great.
Amen.
Such great words to us.
Christ Jesus.
chapter 20, and we took the first part of it the last time, I think, that I preached. And now, Jesus, we just got done with the scribes and the Pharisees are asking Jesus, who, by what authority are you doing this, or who gives you this authority? And of course, we talked about that last time. Well, now he's going into a parable. In verse 9, he starts telling them a parable. And we're going to go start at verse 9, and we'll go through about probably 19. He went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they would put, so they would give him some of the fruit of the vine vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, "God forbid." Jesus looked directly at them and asked, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed." The teachers of the law and the chief priests looked for a way to arrest him immediately, because they knew he had spoken this parable against them. Mm-hmm. But they were afraid of the people. You know, I don't know about you, but one of the things that has always kind of struck me odd is that there were people that loved the Lord. I mean, they would follow him and listen to him preach, and knew that, just knew in their hearts that he was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But there was many people that had no idea who Jesus was. You know, even though he was doing these miraculous things, even though he was expounded to them in ways that no man had ever expounded to them. In other words, he had the wisdom that he could speak to them, just like in this parable. He didn't say, "Now this is for you," but yet it says there at the end of the paragraph that they knew that it was them who Jesus talked about. And so, I don't know, but one of the things, I guess, these people, they had no reason in the world to treat these people that he sent to collect his rent. Because, I mean, it was due. He had rented them this ground. He had allowed them to, if you will, farm it or whatever. And I don't know about you, but at the end of the season, you just know that it's, that you got to pay for using that. And somehow, can you, I don't know about, when I looked at that, I thought, my gosh, how evil was these people that they could even think about defrauding this guy out of his money that they owed him. But yet, that was what was on their mind, was to rent this land for a year without paying for it. And so, why was it not in these people's hearts to say, you know what, we're going to owe this man the rent for his place, so we need to pay him? But in all honesty, they treat the people that he sends to them really bad and beat them up and send them away with nothing, so to speak. Why could they not in their heart see where they were? I don't know. There's people that are able to see that they need Jesus, they need his help, they need him in their life, and then there's other people that seemingly never make that connection. I'm sure you've all seen it. You know, there's people that are on fire for God. And then there's other people, they don't want to even hear about God. And so, I don't know, you know, I guess when I started reading about this and read how they mistreated all these people, it started something in my heart, I guess, was about how that people have treated the prophets down through the ages. You know, they a lot of times they would kill prophets, they would persecute prophets. I think it was Ahab, I believe it was, that Obadiah was hiding. I think it says 100 prophets in two caves to keep Jezebel from annihilating them. I guess that would be the easy word to say. In other words, she was wanting to kill them. Why did Jezebel want the prophets?
They were speaking against her.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
They were speaking against what she was doing and what the false prophets were doing.
In other words, they were confronting her with her sin.
Yep.
Yes.
And instead of looking and saying, you know what, this prophet's telling me the truth, I am a sinful person. But instead of that person being able to look at, instead of Jezebel being able to look and say, you know what, I do need to change my life. But instead of doing that, her reaction was, let's kill the prophets. Let's get rid of the prophets. Because if I get rid of the prophets, won't be nobody else telling me that I'm doing sinful things. And so, here are these people that owe the master. And the master finally comes to this place where he says, you know what? I'll send my son. Let me point something out to you here. Do you not think that this man, if he said, I'm going to send my son, that he thought, surely they would receive my son? I mean, he's not going to send his son if he knows his son is going to get killed. And yet he said, I'm going to send my son. Maybe they'll respect him. Maybe they'll find something in their heart for him. But can I tell you? It doesn't make any difference in their lives. Whether it's the hired hand that he sends or whether it's his own son. Fact of the matter, they treated his own son worse in that they beat him up and bound him up and said, you know what? if he's dead, we can inherit all this. I don't know what that really, how it all ties in God's kingdom. But evidently there's something there where people think they're going to inherit the things of God even if they mistreat his son. Now, I would imagine most everybody in the vicinity, if you was to talk to them about the son, they would all say, oh, we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't do that. We wouldn't think of doing that. And yet, every day, when they're rejecting God's son, in some respects, they are beating him and nailing him to a cross. Amen? Amen. When we reject the Christ, now, here's something I want to give you. Just don't cost you nothing. And it might even be hard to see how this fits in, but I think it's just something good to give to you, for you to take with you. If I suppress the Christ in you, I've also suppressed the Christ in me. Amen? Think about that. If I suppress the Christ in you, because Christ in you, the hope of glory, was the same Christ that should be in me. So if I suppress the Christ in somebody, I'm also suppressing the Christ in me. It's a good thing to carry with you. Because sometimes when you want to get rough with somebody, I once went into Walmart and I went into the bat section and I started hefting the bats because I was going to get me one that felt good to me and I was going to go out and beat somebody up with it. Hmm. Amen? Hmm. Listen, you know what kept me from doing that? This little voice said, Jim, you know that's not right.
Yeah.
Amen. You know you're just going to get in trouble if you do that. And that little voice arrested me. Mm-hmm. How many times?
Thank God.
How many times does that little voice speak to people's hearts and they refuse to yield to it? Mm-hmm. Amen? Can you see why sometimes the world is in the shape that it's in? It's not because God's not real. It's not because he's not alive. But it's because people will not yield to him. And honestly, you know, these people here that were beating up the servants and beating up the son, they could not hear that still small voice that's saying to him, that's not right. This is not right. They could not hear that still small voice. And so, the point that I'm trying to make to you today is this. What was it that kept the biggest amount of people from really receiving Jesus or hearing him speak or knowing that he's God, put it that way? What was it that kept them from doing that? I venture to say, more than anything else, it was a place that they came where they was comfortable and they didn't want to move out of it. In other words, we've been Jews all our life. We've been taught this all our life. This is the way it is. And this is the way it's going to be. And they could not receive what Jesus was telling them because they could not get by their hang-ups just to really say it simple, I'm going to say it like this. They didn't want nobody telling them they was doing wrong. Just like Jezebel, she didn't want the prophets coming along and telling them they're doing wrong. They didn't want John the Baptist coming along and saying, hey, you're going to have to repent. You're going to have to do something here to change your life. And so, people that get to a place, and I want to say this, and I want to say it plainly, people that get to a place that they cannot be touched by God, I don't know what will happen to them, because how are they going to be changed? How are they going to have their life changed? Now, I can stand here before you today and tell you, am I a perfect man? Amen? In other words, am I going to get in because I'm perfect? No. Fact of the matter, I'm going to be real honest with you this morning. If it depends on my goodness, I'm not going to make it. Amen? But I think I read in the book where it depends on Jesus' goodness.
Amen.
Aren't you so glad?
Amen.
That it don't depend on your goodness? I think the one writer said, in myself there is no good thing. Amen? I can honestly say, you know, I might do good. Once in a while, I might even preach a message that somebody gets touched by. But yet, in myself, I can't do no good thing. In other words, in myself, if it was truly left up to me, Lord, tell me what you might hear. Amen. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And I'm going to just read a couple of scriptures here that talks about seeking God, finding God. You know, we're talking about, if you truly want to find God, how can you do it? Amen? What must you do to find the Christ? I want to find God. I want to know who God is. Now, you know, I was talking about people hanging on to their past, I guess you want to call it that, or however you want to say it. I was thinking about this morning. I've had some very godly people in my life that have mentored me.
Amen.
And one of them is Carl Mackey. And him and I would ride around on Sunday afternoons in his pickup truck. And he would just sow into me many, many days. But here's the thing that I want to tell you. If Carl Mackey's God had not become my God, it wouldn't have made a bit of difference. Amen? I can't go through life on Carl Mackey's God. Not that he didn't believe in God, and not that he wasn't a true believer, and not that I don't believe that he didn't help me, but I want to say this to you. You've got to have your own God. You've got to be convinced in your life that your God is your God. Amen? And I think there are many, many people thinking that they're going to make it because they got somebody else's God. And they haven't truly found their own God. They haven't truly had that relationship with God. Now, so what does the Bible tell us to do? I want to go to Jeremiah and I'm going to start in chapter 29 and verse 11. Now listen to this, because there's some truths in here that we need to know. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Listen, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. I want you to hear verse 13. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. In other words, when you seek God with all of your heart, then you will find him. You know, if I'm going to seek God with all of my heart, that means that I can't have nothing between me and God. In other words, I can't have something that I grew up with and carried with me, and it's between me and God. That, can I tell you, that's not truly believing with your whole heart. That's not truly seeking God with your whole heart when you will allow something to get between you and God. Amen? And so, too many people are afraid to let God rule their hearts. I had a young man tell me this one day. He said, I would go to church, but if I go, I'll have to change.
Yeah.
Yep. Amen? The person knew. And here's what shocked me. I thought, well, I've never told you you had to change. Mm-hmm. Amen? Yeah. But yet, in their heart, they had enough of a relationship with God to realize that even though God doesn't make nobody change to come to him, I mean, Billy Graham was come as you are. And yet, this person could not see beyond just coming to God as you are, but he was allowing that to get between him and God. And so many times people allow things to get between them and God. But if you truly want to know God, and listen, we're talking about how wicked these men were that beat up the men that the master sent to collect the money. Can I tell you, without God, you'll be just as wicked? Amen?
Yes.
Without God, you'll be just as wicked as them men were. In fact, you may even be more wicked. But it's when we can allow, you know, my flesh says, I'm not going to pay this guy. I'm not going to give him his money. We're just going to beat up the man that's come for the money and send him on. But God's getting in there. And all of a sudden, he's between you and that man. And he said, you know what? You're going to do it. Over. Listen, church. Can I tell you something? We really do owe Jesus. Amen. We really. There's no way we can ever pay him, but we owe him more than we can ever begin to pay. quick. And this is pretty basically the same thing as this one, but says it just a little bit different. I want to go to Matthew chapter 7, and we'll start at verse 7 and go to probably about 12. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, the door will be opened to you. For everyone who receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. I like verse 8 there. It says, for everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Listen, I'm going to say this to you this morning. If you want to have a true relationship with God, and I know there's people here that do, then you'll have to seek him with all of your heart. Amen? And can I tell you this? When you seek him with all of your heart, you will find him. I'm not so sure if I should say you will find him. I should maybe say he will find you. That may be the better way to say that. That when you're seeking God with all your heart, somehow he finds a way to find you. And that no matter where you are, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you've done in the past, amen, he's there saying, here I am. Whew. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that he says, here I am. Come unto me, ye that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Here I am. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to stop there. I just want to encourage you. Seek God with all your heart. And I will say this, if you don't, you will find yourself doing wicked things. Okay? You will find yourself doing wicked things. I don't know if I ought to really say this or not, but sometimes I think you could even be seeking God with your whole heart and still find yourself doing wicked things. Because it's who you are. From what I can see in the Bible, and I believe that if this was possible, Jesus wouldn't have to have went to the cross, but I'm going to say this to you today. If you could live good enough to make it on your own, Jesus would not have had to go to the cross. Amen. But it's because you're not going to do it on your own. It's because you need help that we celebrated this morning in remembering of the bread and the wine. Remembering what Jesus did for us. It's the only way that you can make it. Is through having that relationship with him. And the only way to have that relationship is to seek him with your whole heart. Amen. You know what that looks like? It looks like this. When I would beat up that man I owe money to, if I'm seeking Jesus with my whole heart, I'm going to come to the place I'm going to say, no, I'm not going to do that. Amen? And we find that place to walk. Not disobey what God's saying to us. And allowing him to lead us and guide us. I want to say this to you this morning, church. I don't bring this kind of a word to make you feel guilty. Amen. You know, I think sometimes in the past, the old church people, they sometimes use the word of God, I think, in error, in that they tried to condemn people. I don't bring this kind of a message for condemnation. I bring this as a positive thing, and that you can say, no matter where I'm at, I can seek God with my whole heart, and I will find him. Amen. Amen. I call it bulldog mentality, and that meaning this, that you know, once a bulldog, once he bites on, it's pretty hard to get him off. Fact of the matter, most of the times they have to use a stick or something to pry their mouths apart. So what I'm saying to you today is get that bulldog mentality, in that I'm going to latch on to God and I ain't letting loose. I ain't letting loose. That's not the proper English, I don't guess, but it works. For a country boy like me, that's the way I say it. I ain't letting loose. I'm going to keep clamped on here until one day Jesus will say, enter in. You finally made it. Not that I've done anything, because of what he's done. Let's go ahead. Father, we just thank you and praise you this day for the wonderful day that you created. Father, we just pray today that you would speak to people's hearts. I'm not just looking at other people, Lord, I'm saying my own heart, that I would seek you, Father, with all my heart. Father, that this church would seek you with all of our hearts. That you would find us, and you would speak to us, and you would begin to lead us and guide us in ways that we've never been led and guided before, Father. Father, we just ask you to look after all those that might not be doing too well physically, that you touch their bodies, Father, whatever it is, from the top of their head to the bottom of their feet. Father, those that are having mental struggles, we ask you to cause their struggles to be revealed to you, to us, Father, that we could deal with these struggles and finally look to you and say, the Lord, he is God. We just thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.